Spellbound is a story about abnormal psychology, about the mysteries of psychoanalysis, the distortions of the human mind, and all of that, I think, was somewhat appealing to Hitchcock, even if he himself was not a person who subscribed to psychoanalysis.
Now, Spellbound was being developed around 1944, released in 1945. So a lot of servicemen were coming home, you know, with some bad dreams and nightmares. And
it's a particularly interesting time period in American history, the mid-1940s. We had a large number of returning veterans coming back from World War II, many of whom had gone through extremely traumatic experiences in wartime.
After the war, men were coming back and they were having what was called shell shock. And what it really is the psyche was overwhelmed. It was just way too much, you know, emotional reality to deal with.
What happened to your hand? Your hand was burned. You've had an operation in the last 6 months. The skin graft, third degree burns. Your hand was burned. Where?
It hurts.
Try remembering.
My hand hurts.
Your hand is remembering. Open your mind and the pain will leave. Where did it happen?
I can't. It hurts.
What happened?
It's burning. My hand's burning.
Try to remember.
I think World War II was very important to Hitchcock. I think he had a very strong sense of duty and patriotism. He made some films about the very painful realities of the war. But I think that in his, you know, more conventional narrative films, it does become a concern.
I think by the time Spellbound was made, a lot of the elements of psychoanalysis have, in a maybe somewhat simplified form, made their way into the public consciousness. So the idea of dream analysis, the idea of repressed memories.
One of the things that made Spellbound acceptable to the American public was, at this period, at the end of World War II, so many families had been touched by trauma. So many families knew someone or had a family member who was seeking psychological treatment.
Spellbound is very explicitly psychoanalytical. And of course, all this is simplified because the sickness is said to be cured once we find the repressed memory, and it will go, so we just have to chug through the plot till we find that repressed memory.
And if we can unlock one tiny memory, it'll give us a key to the others.
No.
It was a different kind of film, but was a Hitchcockian idea in terms of the kind of suspense that could be built.
The motion picture Spellbound is the accumulation of everything that Hitchcock had been referencing and referring to and realizing throughout his entire career. But now it was, instead of the subplot, it wasn't just the psychological motivation of the characters, it was the story.
The psychoanalysis wasn't just for some elite. It wasn't just an idea of a loony bin at the time. It was a valid part, a valid therapy for very real problems in Americans' lives.
So now Hitchcock is taking the psychoses that motivated his characters and making psychoses the plot. And so it was something that he would have to come to that movie one way or another, because he had been speaking to those subjects perennially throughout his career.
Spellbound is what I call a therapy film. The plot revolves around someone attempting to cure somebody. The hunt, as it were, the quest is for a forgotten memory, a repressed memory. There are external people. In the case of Spellbound, it's of course Ingrid Bergman, who is functions almost as a detective as to figuring out what this repressed memory is. And it's almost as if in these therapy films, an external observer is in a better position to know the character's mind than the character him or herself.
I'm sure one of the main reasons that the film was made with its focus on psychoanalysis was the fact that producer David O. Selznick was undergoing psychoanalysis in the 1940s.
The trauma experienced by Gregory Peck's character is a trauma that actually David Selznick experienced in his own life with his brother Myron.
David had an older brother. He was one of the first great agents in Hollywood, and also, rather more important, one of the people who really invented agenting. Myron was a little bit like a gangster, deadly efficient, cynical, tough, could handle himself in a fight in a way David couldn't.
David Selznick and Myron Selznick have a very, very complicated, difficult relationship. And we're talking fist fights at parties.
But I think there was a deep fondness between them. And Myron believed in David. And I think Myron was one of the few people that David listened to without questioning.
Myron Selznick is a severe alcoholic. By the early 1940s, Myron Selznick is drinking himself to death, literally. And David is able to get him into rehab.
He'd researched alcoholism, and he'd worked hard with his wife, Irene, to try and keep Myron alive. They'd failed.
By the time Spellbound is in development, his brother has died as a result of acute alcoholism. And this was very difficult for David Selznick.
That was, I think, a very significant part in the gradual breakdown in David Selznick that occurred in the early 40s.
Meanwhile, he's developing the career of Jennifer Jones. You know, Jennifer Jones is one of a number of women at this time that, along with Joan Fontaine and Ingrid Bergman, et cetera, whose careers he is developing and very successfully developing, and ultimately breaks up his marriage. And so between the death of his brother and the breakup of his marriage and just coming to terms with this all of this, he winds up in therapy.
Selznick had been going to this leading lady in that field in Beverly Hills, Dr. May Rahm, who was a psychiatrist and psychoanalyst. She was hired to be the technical advisor on Spellbound.
He winds up being very supportive of this project that really has been a pet project of Hitchcock.
David Selznick was making a couple of other films at the same time as Spellbound. One of them, Since You Went Away, had a section that dealt with trauma. It dealt with soldiers returning from the war suffering from shell shock.
Since You Went Away is interesting because it is a war film, and it's about three women, a mother and her two daughters. And one of the daughters is played by Jennifer Jones. She actually plays a nurse who attends to shell shock victims. And Selznick is doing lots and lots of research into shell shock and treatment of shell shockers. It's an amazing movie, very successful film, nominated for a slew of Academy Awards. In many ways, a largely forgotten film, but one well worth seeing. So you've got this growing fascination on the part of not just Selznick, but to some extent, actually, the public at large. Just, you know, what the war experience is doing to men and what they're doing and what's being done about it. And of course, you've got, you know, John Huston making this fabulous, you know, documentary about it.
John Huston had done a film for the War Department called Let There Be Light that dealt with the treatment a lot of these men were undergoing. The War Department, when they saw the finished film, thought it was so harrowing and graphic that they didn't allow it to be released.
They kept the feature-length version out of circulation for decades. It was simply too much.
Do sudden noises bother you particularly?
I did just shake over a little bit.
Well, I guess I just got tired of living, you can put it that way.
I had trouble sleeping, yes. Had a dreaming of combat, you know.
I just took off because I see too many of my buddies gone and I figured the next one was for me. A man can just stand so much up there, see.
One of the boys got hurt.
I took him away. I was going over to my competition.
Yes, go on. You remember it now. Tell me. It's all right now, but you can tell me. You can tell me.
Right. There was a tremendous interest with the American public and Hollywood with this idea of battle fatigue. And Fox's musical, with A Song in My Heart, the story of Jane Froman, had a scene in which a character portrayed by Robert Wagner clearly is suffering from battle fatigue.
Some movies and different things were made about it, but nothing formally was ever put in the psychiatric text as this is a disorder and can be rated and can be treated.
There's a famous instance, of course, with General Patton slapping a soldier in World War II who was experiencing shell shock, and it's portrayed in the film in a famous scene with George C. Scott.
What's the matter with you?
I guess I just can't take it, sir.
Patton, he was a taskmaster. He was there to take Hitler and everyone out, and he needed every piece of the machinery, which is mostly made up of human beings. And this soldier had what we know today as PTSD. It would be totally treated different today. But for him, it was looked at as a coward. And even today, it's still looked down by command when a soldier starts having post-traumatic stress syndrome symptoms. Patton mocked him and probably sealed his post-traumatic stress. He had double trauma.
Hell, you're just a goddamn coward. Shut up! Don't admit this yellow bastard. Nothing wrong with him. We won't have sons of bitches who are afraid to fight stinking up this place of honor. You're going back to the front, my friend. You may get shot, you may get killed, but you're going up to the fighting. Either that or I'm going to stand you up in front of a firing squad. I ought to shoot you myself, you goddamn bastard. Get him out of here! Send him up to the front! You hear me? You goddamn coward!
In war, the real world is anything goes. You see the whole gamut. We've seen amnesia. We've seen erratic behavior. We've seen people go catatonic. As soon as you remove them out of harm's way, they didn't even remember that.
Spellbound is really the first Hollywood film to centrally focus on psychoanalysis and distorted mental conditions from World War II to attempt to present it as best it can to the public, to portray psychoanalysis on screen and psychoanalysts as major characters in the film.
The impact of exposure to a traumatic event has obviously been with us as long as mankind has been encountering traumatic events. It's actually the place where we first identified the disorder was amongst the soldiers who had been in Vietnam that led us to come up with a post-traumatic stress disorder or PTSD diagnosis.
Post-traumatic stress syndrome is a disorder. It's not a psyche, it's not something you get, it's something that happens.
It's caused by exposure to some kind of traumatic event, and after the fact the individual continues to re-experience the event in various kinds of ways.
I remember something. Fighter plane spotted us.
You were flying?
Transport Medical Corps over Rome heading north.
What happened?
They hit us. Caught fire. Uniform burn. Bailed out.
Something in the neighborhood of 20% of all active military servicemen that were exposed to more than two consecutive weeks of combat wound up with shell shock. So you had hundreds of thousands of military guys were significant victims of that experience, psychologically, mentally.
In a war situation, what we know now is that to survive, you're in survival mode, it's your life or my life, is that people have to, what they call, dissociate most of their feelings and thoughts, especially the terror, the pain, the fear, the sadness. People come back from war and they're finally safe. They have the luxury to feel what they couldn't feel before. So the dissociative barriers break down, and all of a sudden it could be something like a sound that was similar to a sound that went off.
Many of the sounds in war can be recreated by accident, whether it's a car backfiring, a book falling off a shelf. You hear that sound, and what it does, because the brain is still on hyper alert, is it heightens that sense. Now you visually see that you're in a safe place, but another sense is telling you, watch out.
Of course, Hitchcock is a supremely visual director. So if he's going to portray mental states in a film, he wants to find a way of putting it up on the screen. And it was decided upon that the cue for the kind of psychotic episodes in the film would be a visual motif, and in this case, black lines on a white background, which Hitchcock puts into the film on several occasions, like fork lines, a pattern on a blouse, and these will indeed trigger off Gregory Peck into a mental episode.
Very often they lose their sense of who they are, their identity. Because to split off so many emotions and so many realities, it's like yourself is being shattered and you're taking different parts of yourself and putting them here and putting them there. And sometimes when people are left after a trauma, they're like a ghost of themselves.
Gregory Peck has amnesia in the movie, and usually the amnesia with post-traumatic stress disorder is not total. It's usually more a case of not remembering parts of an event or particular events.
We're always on the verge of that separation, really, from who we are, because a lot of times we forget who we are. You're like in an altered state.
They begin to feel fewer feelings and become very numb emotionally.
You just become invisible. You feel safer.
Often they speak of feeling very empty, hollow, not knowing who they are. not having a ground underneath them.
Many times for veterans that have committed horrific things that you do in war, and a lot of horror comes out of that.
People who have these symptoms usually have difficulty sleeping. They are irritable. They are startled easily.
You start withdrawing from society. Obviously, that behavior is not going to get you a job. You're not going to have any positive relationships. You're trying to avoid any type of situation, so you withdraw. The best place to withdraw is the streets, the woods, someplace where you don't have to be visible.
This is his handwriting.
John Brown, huh? Not much imagination for an alias.
In this movie, the person whose identity he takes on is linked to his trauma in his mind.
Gentlemen, our new chief, Dr. Anthony Edwards.
It is very common to feel guilty about surviving. We call that survivor guilt. Gregory Peck has that in the movie.
I'm someone else, I don't know who. I killed him. Edwards.
It was a highly unusual film. But that, you know, that people would talk about some of these things, and that people would recognize the Hitchcock touches. So that's often consumed his mind, where he was thinking of this will be a great effect.
I think that the greatest part of cinematography in Hitchcock films is that it really delves into the psychological content of the narrative.
With his background in German Expressionism, Alfred Hitchcock was very much into showing us subjective states. He loves to put us into the heads, or you might say into the eyes of his characters.
The kind of thing that Hitchcock loved to do, you know, set himself these tasks. But the tasks were rarely in service of, let me show you how really prodigiously gifted I am. The task was always about, how can I increase the visceral impact? How can I bring the audience more and more into my world? How can I make them feel?
You're an excellent analyst, Dr. Peterson, but a rather stupid woman. What did you think I'd do when you told me all this? Congratulate you? You forget in your imbecilic devotion to your patient that the punishment for two murders is the same as for one.
One of the, of course, images that comes to mind immediately is the giant hand at the end with the gun that sort of tracks with Ingrid Bergman. But that was done really for technical reasons, you know, because they couldn't get a camera that would have the kind of depth of field they needed. They had to construct a giant hand with a giant gun.
He said one of the things that he did that nobody noticed in that picture was when he turns the gun around and shoots himself, Hitchcock actually had two frames of Technicolor red that had to be cut into every single print by hand. I said, do you think anybody noticed it? No, they just felt it.
You know, to me, what's interesting about Spellbound is that despite its attending to psychoanalysis and having a protagonist who's a shrink, it is not as complicated psychologically and psychosexually as in a lot of other Hitchcock films.
Thematically, what we see repeated throughout his career are these concepts of the transfer of guilt, the challenge of innocence against some, you know, darker impulse. I mean, essentially what he did was he popularized the idea that we're all probably a little bit screwed up.
Hitchcock, in some ways, not only one of the great filmmakers of the 20th century, but he's also one of the most experimental filmmakers. So Hitchcock really brings together in many ways more elements of the cinema, the commercial, the personal and the private, and the innovative together in his films, maybe more so than any other filmmaker of the 20th century.